Hey guys, hope you're having a great day as well as a great life.
I mean, I didn't know you already start.
Yeah,
this video is sponsored by Peach Pear LaCroix.
Oh yeah,
naturally tastes
the TV static,
like TV fuzz. Yeah, dude, what are we doing today?
Dude, this is a Rush Wednesday. It's been at least a few months since we've hit Rush. It's been time, and it's time for a long song.
And I had to get hydrated because this is a long song.
Absolutely, and apparently so. The first song is Book One. There's two books, apparently. Yeah. And the first one is in, like, A Farewell to Kings. That album, it's the last song. And then Book Two is the beginning of the Hemispheres album. That's like an 18-minute song.
Crazy forethought.
Did a little bit of research.
That's
yeah,
some forethought.
Dude. It's... How are you going to, like, write an album, finish it, with the other album beginning already in mind like that?
And here's the deal.
It's wild.
I feel like everybody has been requesting this forever. And we really wanted to save it for, like, a treat. Because this is definitely one of those... I think after we listen to it, we're going to be like... Now I understand why they want to watch us react to it.
Yeah.
Like, this is a moment.
Dude, the last long thing we did from Rush was freaking 2112. That was the last long thing we did. You know what I mean? Because that's like a 23-ish right. minute song. So.
Well, you guys buckle in for the ride. Get your own drinks or whatever you partake in when you're listening to the Hemispheres.
Yeah, some greenery.
Yeah. With that being said, let's get into it. Oh, dude. Little bobblehead, guys.
That's how you do it.
See you on the other side.
Oh, right.
Oh, well, I guess I got my glass.
Six. telescopic eye, infinity, the star that would not die.
You think it's the end of the first song?
Yeah, I think so.
We'll be right back.
We've got so many things.
Yeah.
Like, how many things do you need to do all this? Like, a lot. Like, a room full, at least.
Yeah.
Run alone.
teeth shine clear. Sensibility, armed with sense and liberty, with the heart and mind united in a single perfect state.
Is that the song, dude?
Yeah.
Oh my goodness.
It's a lot going on.
Dude, that felt like at least like eight or nine songs.
Yeah, definitely the content worth, yeah. There is, gosh, there's so much to say.
Drums.
Phenomenal. I really loved how off the cusp he was being at the very beginning, but I'll let you go on drums because I had more production stuff that really caught my eye.
I don't know, it's just everything you could have ever wanted from a Neil Peart, dude.
Yeah.
It's like he gave you sauce. He gave you like the slow, like halftime beats and just like all these different things. That
the
like
cool shuffly feels towards the end.
Just anything a regular drummer would just play good. He just plays great and then phenomenal. And then like top tier, legendary, timeless. Yeah. It's just like he's crazy, dude.
I thought was really cool was he was so precise and he was doing these crazy rhythmic things that the band was also doing. So it's like, you have to have somebody who's that good to be able to write the cool rhythm things, but also a band good enough to be able to like, we'll follow you on that. Like also, that's tough.
Also, what I was noting is the fact that towards the end, like in this last section here, or the second to last section, I guess, is that just Rush playing through a progression. How do they make it that engaging?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because I was just jamming with my band the other night and we were just going through some stuff like that. And it's like, it feels like with them, they just add in all these textual pieces, these rhythmic pieces, just all these things that they make it like just a traditional, you know, progression just sound freaking phenomenal.
Well, I think the difference is, and it really is that difference between, like, you can get the first 80% of the sound with, like, 20% of the work. But putting that last 20% elevates the...
So really just, like, the last
It's like an extra 80% of work. And so I feel like the drums are adding in this, like, really, really subtle rhythmic engagement that a normal drummer would just play straight, and Neil's playing it with, like, finesse, right? And the chords, like, when Alex is playing the guitar... This is what I'm hearing is he's adding like a couple extra notes and the tone is just right so that it feels even thicker
it's
and even
like
cooler.
Shuffling too. It just sounds so cool.
So I think it's just everybody's like putting in a lot more effort just to eke out that little
bit. And then Getty, dude, on the bass, dude, he's just adding in texture. Like he's filling all the pockets and all these sonic regions just like fit, like seeing where he can fill in and it's just like insane.
So when he told me about the idea behind the song, which I thought was awesome.
Yeah.
My first thought was this pre-planned? In the fact of, hey, either one, we're going to write the last song on the album, so it's we're gonna write it, and we're going to force ourselves in the next album to write a song right that would go after that. Or was it two, they planned it out, and they said, here's this song we have. Let's chop it in a third and then two-thirds, and we'll release this one, and then we'll release the other part another time.
Yeah.
Ooh, sorry, Bubblehead. And I'm leaning way towards the first one.
Yeah.
Because the writing style felt different. The vocal style felt different. The tonality of the whole piece was just like vastly different than the first, which I think is really cool that they task themselves with like, I don't know what's going to go after this, but we're going to force ourselves to. We're going to write ourselves into a hole because we say book one, like book two has to come at some point.
Absolutely. I'm Alex Lifeson, the guitar solo is in this.
Yeah.
It's just like, it has that rush, you know, that rush that Alex feel where it's just, it just feels different when he's playing a guitar solo from other guitars, just in almost any genre I've heard. Just the way he like pierces through with like his notes is just like insane in the tone of it.
The tone's great. His creativity is impeccable. I want to get into the lyrics.
Let's do it, man.
So that was a fucking book report.
Dude, that was a total book report. It was like a giant epic.
Yeah.
And it ended kind of saying like love and reason. You want them to be like... working together, so like yin and yang almost, like hemispheres, like they're both like working together interchangeably to produce like the outcome that is the best outcome or whatever.
Yeah, it's definitely like how it came across. It's like a parable I'm hearing. Yeah. It's like definitely him trying to give some sort of like point that I think I'm following what you're going with. It's just so dense. It's just so much there.
It's like a giant philosophical epic, but you're like,
yeah. I like how it started out with just some guy in a spaceship that fell into a black hole. And, like, the story of the black hole.
Yeah.
And then it got into, like, all right, now there's a whole world being destroyed and gods are fighting. And the world's being destroyed because maybe gods are fighting or maybe I don't know if one affects the other.
Yeah.
And then they just feel this presence from some guy who got destroyed in a black hole. And they were like, ah, oh, we'll call you Cygnus. You're Cygnus. And he was like, I'm Albert. You're Cygnus.
Yeah.
You know? And then he's like, now you're a god too or something.
And I like how they related it to like Greek mythology, like in that way.
Yeah, I thought it was really cool, especially since constellations and all that sort of, they're so based on like the naming of things is all like Greek gods and Roman gods. So it's like, it's a cool line of direction to go.
Yeah. It's also cool just like the analogy of the way they were describing everything. Like if you look at like the gods, like as just like people in power, how it like so much relates to like our society and, you know, humanity's past and stuff. Of like you have people in power and then just the people at the bottom, like doing all this and that or whatever, but how it like relates, like,
yeah, it's true.
Like how their affairs relate to the masses' affairs.
Yeah. Cause it's all pretty interconnected.
Yeah. And I think it's cool how you can like apply it, you know, similarly. You know what I mean?
One of the things that I meant to talk about when we were listening to the song, and it's something that I think I'm not bothered by.
Yeah.
It's really interesting to me because it's very unique. And it comes about because, well, I'll tell you what it is first. So Geddy, I feel like, is unlike other singers and songwriters, where normally in most songs you have like this string of musical ideas through the voice that are like, you can like subsect them. You can be like, here's a musical idea A that leads right into musical idea B.
Yeah.
Right? What it feels like with Geddy is it's this like one musical section that all comes to like a point at the end and then a musical break with no vocals. And then it's like another separate music, like a vocal section and a musical break. And it's very, very common. I didn't realize it until listening to this. I was like, oh, like it's a musical break. Like once you notice it, it's hard to unnotice it.
Yeah.
But I think it comes directly from like, Neil is the one writing the lyrics and Geddy's singing them. And so I think it's a really cool way of having it where it's
interesting,
like
dynamic. It's different.
Because normally if you're like thinking from the singer and the writer, you're going, okay, my next melody has to go off of this and it has to flow like together because you're writing it in one, you're not writing it in like sections. Whereas Neil is going, here's an idea and a chunk and it's poetry. And then here's an idea and a chunk and it's poetry. And so by reflection,
like, let's figure out how we can like put it.
Yeah.
In
and so by reflection, Geddy is singing that. Here's an idea and a chunk and me singing and here's a break. Here's an idea and me singing. Like, so I just think it's really, really cool. I think their their dynamic is so unique.
How do you feel about how the lyrics and the story like relates to the instrumentals and just like the actual song and songs in general?
Because
I feel like I definitely didn't get all that from the first listen, obviously, because there's so much going on. You know what I mean?
No, I didn't either.
I feel like this is a song that has to like grow on you and has to like have time with you.
Yeah.
Like knowing the lyrics and actually like listening to the sections, I feel like it would make a lot more sense, because like when you listen to it feels like not disjointed because everything's like clean, very clean and tight, obviously, but in terms of like the concepts and ideas, like you're not like able just to grasp onto it immediately.
It's very, you know? this is a comp, like there's like a graph of like stories, like you could tell a simple story very simply, you could tell a simple story complex, you could tell a complex story simply. I feel like this is that last quadrant where it's like a complex story told very complexly. So not bad, it's just very dense.
It's like you have to do work to like truly appreciate like what's happening.
What I'll say is I think I liked the second book way more than the first book.
Yeah.
I liked them both. But I think the first book built more atmosphere for me. I definitely got closer to understanding what it was about by the music
that makes
in the
sense.
First one than I did in the second one.
Yeah.
But no, I thought both of them were really awesome. What are we rating them?
I think I'm gonna give this song an A, I think. In terms of my current, I'm trying to reevaluate my rating system, and this is also Rush. And I feel like of like Rush's discography, I like this a lot. I feel like there are other cuts that I enjoy more that feel like they flow more. But like I said, I feel like this song is definitely a grower. I feel like it's just going to take time for me to really be able to appreciate it at that A plus or like S level. But I love a lot of what I heard here.
Here's what I'll say. I think book two for me is an A plus. I think book one is an A minus. So I think it averages to an A. Same thing. I think we're doing A.
But either way,
jeez, all right.
Very awesome, impressive stuff from Rush.
Yeah, big behemoth of a song. What do we do next?
Yeah,
because I don't know what the direction, you know, what do we do? That being said, we'll see you next video.
Later.